going to learn a huge amount, I hope, here this evening from our founder, Rachel Delacour. So can I please get you all to stand up on your feet and give a warm welcome, please, to Rachel.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rachel, for being here this evening.
Thank you. The golden chair.
So I'm going to start by asking the obvious question. I introduced you as having a role as a financial controller, but I lied. I have no idea what a financial controller is, or why somebody would want to stop being a financial controller. So what
no one really wants to become a financial controller. But no, I had this passion with data, and I had this business school, you know, very traditional path. And actually, it was indeed very boring, but I learned a lot about managing a company, about, you know, what the kind of metrics, KPIs, was interesting. And then I got this frustration about not being able to get access to the right data at the right time. And I went from a very large company where I had those business intelligence solutions, you know, with a push button, but I didn't understood the pain from the IT guys, you know, to put this kind of superb solutions, you know, in my to give me access to that. And then I went to work for another smaller company, but it was still a company doing something like 200 million euros, you know, per year, but they had just Excel sheets. There were no business intelligence solution. So I said, oh, guys, that's fine. I will, you know, implement that. And actually, it was super difficult to find something just cheap, just affordable, just easy to use. So I said, okay, I won't stay too much time in this new company, so sorry for the project, but I will leave this company and try my own way in the software industry. So I've met with my co-founder, who was much more techie, you know, than me, and we've built the product of our dream in the business intelligence area. You can have, you know, great ambition about business intelligence, and I was, you know, giving lots of insight about user interface, what I would love to use as a financial controller to understand my data, to the kind of analytics I would like to build. And my co-founder was on the techie side, and we wanted to add something, to bring something much more modern on the market. So we used all those new technologies available at this time, so 2009 when we've launched the solution, and it was about cloud, it was about AWS, you know, and it was about rich interface, we wanted really to change everything and to just please ourselves. And I was sure that if I was able to bring this kind of dreams business analytics, you know, solution to just my other coworkers, that would be a hit. And actually, it was much more used by marketers, by people who were just in need for SaaS solution, you know, in the business analytics area.
So just to go back then to the point where you'd left the big company, you joined the small company, and you found out that this 100 million euro company was using Excel. Like, you're still in a similar position than lots of other financial controllers. A lot of people go through that pain. What was different about you at that time that made you decide, fuck it, I'm going to start a company? Because not many people do that. Most people just like they suck it up or they go work somewhere else that has better tools. Why did you think you could?
There were so much. The market was so much in need for that. You know, if I was able to tick the right boxes, you know, I was sure. I was a big believer in the fact that there were these needs. There were this potential market fit. You know. And that at this time I had nothing really to lose also. Voilà. So what I lost is that I lost my Parisian well-paid job. My parents, my friends, everyone was worrying about all that. And we went back home in our teenager bedrooms, you know, while you are 28 years old, so it's difficult. But it was the good time for us to say, okay, we think that we can really change the world of the business intelligence, get rid of traditional and very dusty solution. We want to change the business model. We want to make it super easy to use, really easy to just to buy, you know, on a monthly basis with a credit card. And this is at this time when we were thinking about this kind of product, we didn't realize that we were also ticking the box of scalability. You know, because we were not in this startup, the startup phenomena is it's something quite new. You know, everyone wants to launch his tech startup. But at this time, we didn't know that we were launching a startup. Actually, it was one of local regional incubator who contacted us saying, "Oh, we are hearing from you." You know, but we didn't really knew that we didn't have any phantasm about startups.
So you said that the worst thing that you thought you could lose was your cozy Parisian lifestyle. But you didn't think that you were a startup that was going to build something that, like, was your ambition to change the world of cloud analytics?
Yes.
Or to be massively successful, or both? Did you want to go back to Paris?
At first we just wanted to understand, okay, are the new technologies available? Okay. Our allies, you know, to make something work. We realized really rapidly that we had enough in our, you know, environment, the new technologies to help us to, you know, to achieve on this vision. Mm-hmm. And what was great is that because we were using cloud technologies, etc., we've put our first version of the solution of our BIME software online. It was a freemium version. We were so ashamed about the first version, but I think we all have to be. But it was a period where we had lots of feedback, and we saw that there were lots of interest coming from. You are on the web, you know, so without many efforts, you are seeing some markets who are much more mature, you know, to use or just to test your solution. So this is when we've understood that, okay, it was disruptive, the way we were thinking of it. It was, the market was in need. We started to have traction from the US, just from an interest standpoint, you know, people asking for demos, etc., everywhere except from France, to be honest. So it was the other stories. We were big believers that we would start our solution, you know, coding, etc., from our bedroom, you know, from our parents' house in the south of France, and then we will be back to Paris, finally showing our friends that we were back. But we had absolutely no traction in France. Even people, you know, CTOs from large companies saying, "Boy, it will never work. Forget about that. No one will want to use a business intelligence in a web browser. Are you kidding? No one wants to put its data on the cloud." So while it was a completely different, you know, discussion with the same kind of CTOs, same industry, same size of companies from the US, from UK, from Northern Europe. So we've stayed in Montpellier.
So talk about those early pieces of traction and those conversations you were having with these companies in the US, everything but France. How did you convince them that this small teenage bedroom startup in the south of France was the right disruption for them? Because most people are afraid of disruption, except for entrepreneurs.
So first, you don't say that you are demoing from your bedroom. Never. You are super serious, you know. So this is something we are much more comfortable to talk about. But during the first years, you'll never talk about that. Product first. The product, and are you? It was a time in 2009, 2010, where the few actors in the business intelligence software industry, they were all on premise. They didn't want to go in. They didn't want to really create cloud solutions because there were some sort of cannibalism also for them, and they were all absorbing. They were all acquiring themselves. So it completely stopped innovation in the business intelligence area, and there were actually a highway for us to innovate, whether we were from Europe, from the US. So we were at this point, let's say, 2 to 3 startups, and 2 coming from California, from San Francisco, really innovating in this area. So we've managed to catch attention of of customers, you know, who were fed up with traditional business intelligence, who were small companies who couldn't afford traditional BI, while every business, whether you're small or you are a big company, you need to create dashboards, you need to monitor your business. So it was so easy to test our solution, you know. And nobody really knew that we were French, because since the beginning we knew that there were no way to communicate in French. So we've started to communicate right away in English, okay, despite this. if you are hiring, you know, I normally never say that because it's super startup stuff, but we hired our first UK English speakers who helped us to write blogs and content and our website in pubs. I put some announcements, you know, in pubs saying, okay, we are in need for English speakers better than me, so please join the... and one of them is still with us. Voilà.
One of the people that you found in the pub?
Very interesting English guys, because the south of France is attracting lots of UK, from people from the UK, from Ireland as well. I think you are all spending your holidays with your parents when you're kids in the south of France, so there is something with Montpellier for UK people, and actually it helped us a lot to hire our first English speakers.
You mentioned some of the risk earlier on, in terms of like the personal risk for you and your co-founder, but you must have had some fuel to be able to grow that company initially. So did you take advantage of any like granting or any government supports or early investment?
During 18 months, at least 12 months, we really coded to have with no initial subsidies or else, you know. It was only with our own savings, very few, but we were working really hard, so we didn't need any kind of financial external fundings. But when we've seen that we started to add some traction, it was also a time where my role also was, I was communicating about what we were doing to get lots of feedbacks, to be sure that we were coding the right features, etc., keeping our vision in mind. But it's also a time where we started to attract attention from some governmental, you know, agencies who said, okay, maybe if we are sponsoring those guys, we absolutely would like to sponsor you. So my role was to have this kind of facing, you know, mission, and we've managed to add an important subsidy from the French government. We won a national competition, and I understood that, you know, when you are in a red position at the bank, or black position,
probably black.
Okay, in France it's
to be in the
green. Okay. I know that there is a color stuff. So I wanted to leverage this amount of money to go to see some business angels to be sure that we were having much more money to start to recruit more people to join us. And it's also a time when we were seeing that the US market was much more mature than any other market. So all the time I was spending also on social networks, I used and abused of LinkedIn by this time, you know, to connect to the right person. So at some point I got some good feedbacks, and also from people who wanted to invest in our company. So I managed to have get some business angels from the US investing in our very early stage company. And it was very important for us, for the rest of the story we had.
So the experience that you had before as a financial controller, and like you were working for some big companies like Carrefour and companies like that, but your own personal experience had been financial controller, running big teams, reporting, the prospect of scaling a team, yep, raising investment, bringing on new customers, a commercial role for the first time.
Yeah.
How are you educating yourself about that? You know, were there other startups that you were looking at saying, the way that they did it perfect, the way that they did it terrible?
On my side, the fact that I was very accustomed with to work with figures, you know, and with what is profitability, what is, you know, I was not afraid to raise funds or, you know, to have this kind of discussion with business angels or even with VCs. We've never used any intermediary, you know, any private bank or this kind of thing. Even for the acquisition, we've dealt with Zendesk directly. I knew how to, it's not that I knew because I've never done that before, but I was at ease with this kind of discussion. When you're not at ease with this kind of discussion, you have to acknowledge that as soon as possible. And this is why there is some intermediary people, you know, doing that. It depends on the time you will be able to dedicate to that. It was my role as a CEO and a CFO because I've been the CEO, CFO until the acquisition. So I knew that it was one of my strengths, but when you know that it's not of your, you know, it's not a strength, you have to rely on people who know that. And yes, it's painful to give up on 3 to 4% each time because it's so complicated to raise money, you know, but you have to acknowledge, okay, are you saving times or not? What are you really able to do? So
at this point, you'd raised some small money at seed, you started growing your team and you had some traction in the US.
Yeah.
At that point in 2000 and the Alvin Capital round.
2013.
Like, was there a lot of investors coming knocking on your door? How did you go about choosing Alvin versus the other partners?
I've always seen my investors, whether it's business angels or even VC, as partners. They are not just the guys who are giving you money. They are here. I've always looked for smart money. It's really important. It's so difficult to compete, you know, with other big companies elsewhere, etc. So the more smart people you have on the board table, the best. So I was always looking for smart money and partners. Okay, you need to have very good, very easy discussions. You need to have to understand whether these partners or these VC or investors. What about the bad news call? You know. Will it be easy to have a smart discussion with this person? So I know that Alvin.
How do you test that though? Because
you can feel that.
Every investor
says. So you know what? It's on you as well as a CEO, as a founder, to make your own due diligence about the because those VCs, business angels, they are doing due diligence on your business, but you have to do your own due diligence on those guys. You can call companies of their portfolio to know how they are on a daily basis. What are the kind of smart advices they are giving you? You know, it's your role also to do your own due diligence. And with Alvin Capital, I know that each time we were speaking at tech conferences, etc., they were always waiting, you know, to talk to us, etc. They were the only one to do this kind of. You know, just they wanted to build a relationship with us as soon as possible. So we really appreciated that, the fact that they were spending time, you know, to just meet us and know more, etc. And they had very good referrals. Their portfolio was very SaaS, B2B oriented in particular. So for me, it was also a way to tap into other CEOs' advices, like advisors, you know, in your own industry, you know, it's so you have also to choose your business angels, VCs, for all what they can bring you at a personal level, but also from their portfolio. If you are a SaaS B2B, try to go to kind of VCs who are investing mostly in the, because from a KPI standpoint, from a benchmark standpoint, it's so positive, you know, for your business.
Can we talk a little bit about growing the team then? And the decision to start putting people on the ground, because I think, you know, a lot of people will look at SaaS and say, look, the dream is I can make money while I sleep. My whole team can be asleep. I don't need anybody to actually sell anything. But you do need somebody, or you did feel the need to put somebody on the ground in the US. What the question is, what was the timing? Why did you feel that was the right time to go and invest that amount?
I had this question today where someone said, okay, Rachel, when did you, at which level of MRR generated, so monthly revenue, monthly recurring revenue, when did you started to think about, okay, this is the right MRR to go to the US. And actually, it was not the way we were thinking. Actually, it's because we had more and more customers coming from the US. And the cloud is fantastic. The whole planet is your playground, but there is still those time zones. And when your customers are complaining for X reasons, and they are from they are in San Francisco, 9 hours of difference, you know, you can't.
I'm eating from Dublin.
Wait, so pardon. you can't wait for just waking up in the morning. So, and you can't ask your team to work at night. So. When we started to miss revenue opportunities, when we started to have too much customers, you know, asking for support, etc., and that there were too much hours, you know, to answer them, this is when we've raised 3 million euros with Alven Capital. Mm-hmm. It was the main reason for the Series A to go to the US and have a local team dealing with the local market. And for me, it was also a way to show that, okay, there is this SaaS business, and yes, indeed, you are doing business while you are sleeping because credit cards are entered. You know, when you have this scalable solution, scalable billing, you know, when everything is scalable, that's great, that's fantastic, but we needed to have a local team dealing with local customers. And if I was able to show that we were good at doing that, okay, it was the US, with the right processes, with the right way to deal with our teams overseas, maybe we would be able to duplicate that same thing in Latin America, in South America, in Asia. So it was a way for me also to show that scalability. So I really wanted to, after it's really great adventures. Huh? So you have this you are tweaking your technology to be as scalable as possible. And then you are trying to tweak your processes, you know, the way you are organizing your team to be as scalable as possible as well. So it's lots of nightmares, but it's
great. So one of the things I noticed when I was, you know, doing some research on you is that you've mentioned we a lot here. We need to go to the US. We need to build a team, but you're very focused on Rachel as the personality is the wrong word, but like, you know, you represent the company as one of the founders. Like your Twitter account is "I'm Rachel," you know. On your LinkedIn profile, it's "We Are Cloud Rachel." Like, I see those little things. So that was you. You had to go out to the US. What was that like? You know, because you had built up a successful team in Montpellier, and then you had to take yourself out of that team and trust that they were going to be able to continue clocking those credit cards and take on those new challenges. Was that a big decision for you to personally have to go out?
Alors, another huge problem, we can say that, huge problem. At a personal level, we were married co-founders. So it was difficult to split the co-founders. So me going to the US and having my co-founder / CTO / managers of all my engineers, you know, staying in the south of France, because we had all our teams there, and French engineers are very good. So we couldn't split, so we made that decision to actually find a strong leader, strong local leader, to represent us, you know, to be sure that we, and after it was after it was super exhausting also, but you as a founder, you have to travel very, very regularly, you have to empower your local leader, you have to give him so much ego in front of the local team so that this guy is really able to personify, you know, to personalize the culture you are trying to establish. So yes, it was what we've done is that one of our business angels who started to invest in our company early on, one of the US guys, he actually started also operationally to work with us. So it was also a way to, he was not a founder, but he knew the company since the early days. So it was a good way for us to, but this is something I worked on, you know, knowing that when you are going to the US, you need lots of interaction, you need lots of network, you need US people to help you to recruit, to lead a team. The choice we've made to go to the US, you know, it was mostly to answer customers. So it was a sales team, support team, you know, so this go-to-market team. You are not training a sales team. You are not, you know, the same way you are dealing with a European sales team. The codes, the way the motivation are not the same. In the US, you are putting cash on the tables for the first one who is picking a phone call. In France, it's taboo. You can't do that. It's a sacrilege. You know, you're not
cash is taboo.
Cash? No. You're never doing that. Those guys in the US, they were doing a huddle each morning, you know, to motivate themselves. I would have never think about if I had to go to the US, you know, to help those guys, you know, to ramp up those guys. I would have never think about doing this kind of things. So this is why a local leader for this sales team with the local DNA, sales DNA, US DNA, it was super important. Compensation plan, etc. It's completely different with my French sales team, my European.
So you can recruit locally. I mean, that's fascinating. That, like, you know, that the two mindsets are so different, right? So you can recruit locally to have somebody who can understand the DNA of that sales team and that support team. But there's still two challenges. The two teams in Montpellier and Kansas still have to talk to each other. They still have to be able to communicate and use the same terminology and still be able to work effectively. Yeah. And then you've got values. They still have to share the same values, even if the DNA is different.
Yeah.
How did you figure that out?
Just to reloop just with the question before. So the fact that we were two married co-founders, actually, it helped us to start to scale this company this subsidiary in the US. So it was a good way for us to try to replicate in other countries. So we were forced actually to do something that could have been a big failure, but it came with lots of travel from myself, from my co-founder as well. And you have to be sure that you are sharing the same values, etc. You have to do lots of cross-pollination of employees. It seems basic to say, it's very, you know, easy to say that, but there is visas, there is a legal obstacles, you know, when you are expanding in another country and in the US in particular. So plus you don't have lots of money, you know, to allow your teams, both teams, you know, to travel. I know that lots of, at this time, lots of, Zendesk, for example, since the beginning, they've allowed their teams to travel, you know, very easily, with no particular meetings or else, but all those guys from different offices, they were able to travel. So it's super expensive to do that. But if I had to do that, to launch a new company, this is something that I would allow, for example, because it's a strong benefit on the long term, you know, to mix that culture between offices. I tried to save too much money on this. The travel of the different teams, it was only triggered with because of a reward, for example. Okay, very good sales. Okay, you're allowed to go to the Montpellier, south of France. You know, you are winning this this trip. But I should have allowed much more.
Why do you say that? Do you think it caused the wrong kind of behavior amongst the teams, or
no? It's because I think that from a culture standpoint, just for the fun factor as well between teams, you know, it's really important to trigger that, to give them this it's in Kansas City. It was a very young team, so the more, and each time they were coming in Montpellier, they were learning a lot from a product standpoint, from the culture of the company, what we were celebrating in France in particular. So I should have done that. So we were doing that at some point. We've also allowed some of our marketing sales guys from Montpellier to spend 3 to 4 months in the US to ramp up the team, but it was not enough. For example, I should have allowed also full-time employees to go to the US, yes.
Talk about the actual hiring process. Were you involved in all of the hiring, even in the US? Because at some point you're going to have to, like, you know, remove the screen and say, ta-da, we're actually French, you know, and you can't hide the accent in an interview. You know, did it scare away? It's the truth. Did you find that was difficult to say, you're going to work for a French company now, Mr. Kansas?
We've been a little bit trained with my co-founder, you know, because we were incubating internationally from Montpellier, because we had to answer all our international leads, you know. Even before the US office, we had to hire people from the UK, people speaking Russian. We had young sales guys coming from Finland, from the US as well, in Montpellier. So we had to understand how to hire people, smart people from everywhere on the planet, because of our needs, because of our incoming leads. And when we've started to recruit in the US, so we knew that it would be super difficult. Our VCs were saying that. All my French co-founders of startups, you know, who already started the business in the US, they were all saying, be careful, they are super good to sell themselves, but when you are scratching a little bit, they are not so good. But, you know, in the US, they are starting to sell themselves since they are 4 years old. So they are so accustomed in an interview to shine. And each time I was having some interviews with US people, I was, I give you my role as a CEO, you're so good. But I was first impressed by the fact that they were much more fluent than me. And that's fine because they are US, you know, they're American. So I was impressed by that. I was impressed by the confidence they had. But you rapidly understand that you have to check references, you have to do this kind of work, because there is lots of disappointment at the beginning. This is also why, knowing all that, having done, you know, some tests in Montpellier, I said, okay, I need this strong US leader to recruit my team. He knows which people I need, which kind of profiles, but I don't want to spend time like that. I'm not good. You have to acknowledge also when you're good, when you're not. And you want someone from the US knowing those shining effects, you know, and just looking for the competencies behind. So this person, so my leader and my business angels, you know, who started operationally with us, helped us tremendously. And what helped us tremendously is the fact that we've picked Kansas City to open this US office, because we were there is this sense of urgency when you are a startup. You have to deliver, you have to show that your investments to go to the US, you have to generate revenue from this US market, you know, as soon as possible. You have no choice. You have not so much money, so you have no choice, and time is so precious. So with the choice of Kansas City, it was also a way for us to be the big fish, okay? Because I knew that in San Francisco, I was nobody. I knew that in New York, I was nobody. Plus, I had not enough money for that, for both cities. So I knew that my first step would be, okay, I need to go to the US, but to recruit people, the right persons, but let's try to find some good idea that fit the cards I have in my game, in my card game, and we've picked Kansas City because there were Google, you know, starting this Google Fiber in this city. There were an initiative of the local officials, you know, government initiatives about launching a Silicon Prairie. So having this European tech company arriving at this time, we benefited from lots of PR about what our arrival, you know. And I remember that it was like a red carpet, and we arrived on day one, and I made lots of radio interview, TV interview, and it was super fun, right? At a personal level also, it was, what's happening? That's just, we were super lucky also, I have to acknowledge that. But we were seen as the sexy European tech companies benefiting from this Silicon Prairie, etc. Wow, look at Kansas City, we are at the beginning of a strong tech story, we will be the next Silicon Valley. So we were benefiting of all that. And on day three, I had more than 80 resumes on my desk to start to build that team, you know. It's in San Francisco, it would have never happened, these kind of things. So when your goal is to show to your VCs, to your financials, and to yourself, to your team, to your customers, that you are really selling your product you are asking a local American US guys to sell your product to the US market, and it's working. You know, that's already huge, actually.
So aside from the fun of appearing on Kansas City local radio, which sounds wild, you've talked an awful lot about the headaches of this, right? I mean, like, you know, the headaches of finding the people and finding the route to growth in the U.S. Was this something that you had envisaged? Did you imagine that this is what it was going to be like to grow the business? And were you still having fun? Because, you know, you had talked about being the disruptor and building this new product, this new category that was going to revolutionize BI. Did you still find that you had time to deliver on, or to focus on that? Or were you just caught up in this grind?
Step by step, you know, you are choosing your battle, your battles. You know, every quarter there is another goal. You know, so during those first 3 months, we really wanted to assemble a sales team. You know, to help us to sell. I knew that it was not a very senior team, but I was not at the stage of a company where I could be attractive enough, you know, to get the attention of much more senior guys, because we were building this success story, you know, through time. So you also have to acknowledge that step by step, you know, don't forget the goal, you know, but to reach that goal, okay, you start by assembling this team, you deliver on that, you generate revenue, then okay, you have you ticked much more boxes, you know, to sell your story for a Serie B, maybe. And this is what actually I was starting to do, you know, by the time we've been approached by Zendesk, I was preparing a Serie B with US investors, because I've managed to show that we had unconventional way to develop our business in the US, but we were delivering on our MRR, on our ARR, on our metrics. We were having this right fit with the engineering team in France and the marketing go-to-market team in the US, and that, yeah, the we were generating revenue. We had the right KPIs, and this is already what we want to prove.
And for yourself, you know, in terms of your own personal time, you know, you had started out being the CEO and the face of the product and the face of the disruption. And then you were also doing some CFO stuff, because that's just your core skills. Right. Did you find that as you were building out the US team with this leader, this business angel, that they were replacing some of that activity for you and allowing you to focus on new things, or was it more complementary?
No, we really wanted them to focus on our sales machine, our sales enablement, you know, processes. We wanted to be sure that we were starting to set the right schema, you know, to grow this sales team, but also in the world, okay. And on my side, everything related to cloud business intelligence, to business analytics, on web, you know, cloud based, etc. All for this. Topics were very hot in California, in San Francisco. All my main competitors, they were in San Francisco. So at some point, the PR noise around that, you know, was in San Francisco. So I had to give the illusion that we were also part of that game in San Francisco. So it was on me also, it was my role to network a lot in San Francisco, to give that illusion that we were in San Francisco. I had a very shadow desk, you know, I don't know how to say that, but in San Francisco. And it was super exhausting, because I tried to stop by, so I, before the acquisition, during more than 1 year, I was once a month in San Francisco to network, to tell our partners. We were very close to, we were the first BI front end on top of Google BigQuery. And everything was happening in Mountain View, so I had to be there to build on that kind of relationships and revenue opportunities. So I had to be there. And I was stopping not once a month to see the KC team, but you have to build that. You have to build your PR story, your image, the fact that you are competing with the San Francisco competitors. It was our story. But there is, you need also to have this sales machine, you know, generating revenue. So because you have to show that your business is growing, and it was a way for us to build something healthy, something sustainable. You know, having me continuing on the with at less risk. You know, because I didn't want to bring all my team in San Francisco. I had not enough money for that. I was really afraid of this huge turnover that companies in California are facing. So I wanted to preserve my team in Kansas City, show that we were growing the business. I rely on me to not go to another company. So in San Francisco, I knew that I was not corruptible or something like that. So yes, it was on me, but at some point it's not completely scalable, but it was okay. At this stage of our development, and this is also when I was networking in the US, it was also to prepare my Series B, to prepare the kind of new SVP, you know, much more senior manager that could join the story, because they were seeing that our MRR was like that. They don't really care about, okay, is this generated from Kansas City or else? They just want to be part of a success story, and a success story is a business that is generating money and adding value for the and disrupting the industry.
Did you have a line of failure? So let's say that you said you spent a year doing this torturous sounding. Right.
You had time. Kids in between.
And family. I can't even imagine how you managed to do that. But you spent about a year, you know, getting prepared. Did you have a line that said, "This is the shit line"? You know, and if we get to this point and we haven't gotten the right signals from the market, from an investment perspective, or potentially the acquisition, I'm going to stop. Because you said you're a data person. You know, were you looking at some number?
I knew that with the trends we had, with our VCs in France, they were our French VCs. They were they wanted to follow us for a Series B. But I also picked them because they had an international network of other VCs. So I knew that my Series B with the Google partnership we had was generating revenues. I knew that I would manage to have this Series B done with US VCs. I showed that I proved myself, my team, my VCs, and the future VCs that we were building something sustainable. So I knew that all the time I was spending in the US, it was not for nothing, but it doesn't come for free, of course. But I knew that it worked. Yeah.
Why? What was worth it?
Because we were...
And for you, like, what was the ambition there? I mean, you know, was it the Series B and taking, like, a whack of money off the table for yourself? Or what was driving you? What was the...
To create an empire. My goal was really to create an empire. But we had another...
Step one, create an empire.
But of course, you need to have this ambition. I really wanted to... We were disrupting the way business intelligence was consumed, the value that we were adding to customers. We were able to work with the Salvation Army, the American Nurses Association, but also with the Justice Ministry of British Columbia. So, you know, we knew that our playground, even from a use case standpoint, was huge. So we were building on that. So. Plus, you need to be completely crazy and ambitious, or you are not spending your time in the economy class to go to the San Francisco each month, you know. So you need to be resilient, knowing about the next step. But it's a step by step, you know. You have to, we've always been very practical people. It's a business is working when it's generating revenue. So it was our way to think about a successful business with my husband. Of course, we knew that we had something potentially scalable, that we could create an empire in the sales B2B software industry. But it was about, you know, generating revenue, showing that customers were really in need, that we had a market fit. And step by step, you are showing all that. And then this is where normally, smart VCs, they must follow you, you know.
Talk then about the the shift in thinking then to a point where the Zendesk conversation becomes more interesting? What's that enabling you to do? Because that's, you know, they're not going to be focused directly on revenue. They're going to talk an awful lot about more your strategic focus, I guess.
Yeah.
So what was that transition like then from away from the Series B to the acquisition?
Yeah. So when we were starting to think about this Series B and when I was starting to work on it, this is a time when we've been approached by Zendesk, and it was it went very fast. We've been approached in June, and after three months later, we were communicating about the acquisition. So it's super super quick, super fast. To be honest, Zendesk as a SaaS B2B company, they were our rock star. We didn't have poster in our bedroom, but almost, you know. Zendesk, we were so fan of this company, the KPIs they had, the way they were coming from Europe as well, so they had this successful US story, global story. So being approached by your rock star, it's really emotional at first. So we are super flattered. And then we understood the clearly and all the ambition they had about their data strategy and how we could really fit to this data strategy, to having access to 100,000 companies, including Airbnb, Uber, etc. That's wow, you know, it's challenging from a technical standpoint, and it's all what we had in mind with my co-founder, hashtag husband. we could go from point A to point B, you know, much more faster than if we had to do that all by ourselves. So it was a fantastic opportunity from a business development standpoint. And also what was really important when they've approached us is actually the culture fit we had with the team. It's so important, so important. Because I called a lot of other founders who've been acquired, and they told me, Rachel, actually we've messed about not giving enough importance to the culture fit when the others have been acquired. And actually it's the name of the game also, because there is an honeymoon until the signature of the papers, you know, for acquisition, and this is when the hard work is starting. The and by hard work I'm mentioning integration, time zones that are different as well. Mm-hmm. It's super difficult to all the mid management, all the persons, you know, in between, with all the new processes, etc. So if there is not a strong culture fit, you need to know that you are in good company, you know. Because it's so complex, so difficult, that if you are not in good company, it's just too hard, you know. So culture fit, data strategy, it was very important for us.
Just to go back to the previous question on the culture piece as well, then how did you test it? Because, you know, culture is usually what emerges when shit goes really wrong, right? It's, you know, then you know what your culture is like. Well, we couldn't possibly do this because our culture says that's impossible. So how did you go about testing that? How did you get a sense that the Zendesk culture was the right one for you?
What has been key is that, so they called us, let's say, I think it was a Thursday. We would like a demo, etc., of your product. And at the end of the call, they said, oh, by the way, we would be interested to meet you. At least there is a partnership on the table. And we said, okay, what are the next steps? Okay, we are coming next Monday. From California? Yes, and someone from Melbourne as well is coming. And there will be also one of our co-founders. What? Okay, so you prepare everything. Okay, you try to. It's super difficult also to deal with your team, because they don't understand. And nothing is done, so you can't say too much about that. But so on Monday, we are seeing three persons, including one of the co-founders of Zendesk. And but it was great, because we having a co-founder meant so much for us, the way he was caring about ourselves, the kind of questions, the kind of... It's superhuman. It's just from a relationship standpoint, you can see easily if there is a fit or not.
Was Byme the first company that Zendesk had acquired?
No. They've acquired another company called Zopim from Singapore, and it was 18 months before 2 years before our acquisition. Okay. Yeah. So I also talked about to the first acquired, and he had a very good experience as well. So you know, it helped also to understand that. And then we had very quickly a call from the CEO, from the current co-founder and CEO, Mikael Svein. And it was super important to spend time with him also physically to know his position and all that, and to have someone very transparent about the difficulties, the fact that he was the one to tell me, you know, Rachel, it's a current honeymoon, but after this is when the hard work is starting, and just to have this kind of realistic view, you know, and it's helping a lot. And Zendesk is full of benevolent people, you know, benevolent. It's really important. Yeah, for my team as well. It was you want to be in good company. Yeah.
So you right now currently you have a very active role within Zendesk. You know, you've got the Zendesk Explorer, which I think is where Bime Analytics transitioned into, and then you also have an evangelist role for the startup ecosystem. So You're definitely Zendesk, right? You drank the Kool-Aid. Did you ever consider just stepping back and saying, you want the product? There you go.
When I've been acquired, I was 6 months pregnant. When I was signing the papers, you know, I was like that. So with this big bump. And so I had the baby, 2 months or 3 months after the acquisition. So this is really hard times, lots of... emotion at the same time. Okay, you've been acquired, and what about your team? What about the organization? What about the new processes? You have an integration to deal with. Oh, so many customers to please, and you have this baby. So, and plus I had already one other kid. It was super tough. To be honest, it was super tough. But there is this big organization who is helping you. They knew that I was pregnant, so. You know, there were no surprise about the bride, you know, the acquired bride. They knew that. So they helped me a lot. And I'm not in need to step back. For sure, I want to give back to the French community. I want that our story make some children, you know, I want to duplicate this story. There is a, not to duplicate the way it is, but you know, just show to the French startups, and there are plenty that are really successful in the US, but just to participate and give back to the current French and European ecosystem, because we will make it. And I'm spending much more time into, for example, an association which name is France Digital. And the goal of France Digital is really to do much more lobbying towards the current government, even if our president is quite pro-startup, but we can't give up, and we have to lobby, to do much more lobbying actions to be sure that we have better tax environment, we have a better environment for US VCs to invest in France, and also for young French entrepreneurs so that they are not flipping all their businesses in the US. So I'm trying to give also, so this is why Zendesk knew that I have this startup, ambition also for my country, so they also let me do much more evangelism, and they are using what I know well, you know. I am also the program manager of our works incubate at Station F. I don't know if you know Station F. It's a fantastic initiative. I encourage you to visit Station F if you stop by Paris. And Zendesk has a workspace for incubated startups, okay? And startups who are close to our industry, you know, customer relationships, support, etc. We are incubating those startups, and they are benefiting from our network, from our portfolio opportunities within Station F.
Okay. So I'm going to go to the floor in a couple of minutes. Maybe we'll take some questions. So if you guys have questions, you want to get ready. But just before we do that, and to go back to... say life. Okay, maybe the process of the acquisition and life after the acquisition, mm-hmm. when you transitioned in. What was surprisingly hard about that, and what was surprisingly easy about that process?
What is hard is the 9 hours difference between the San Francisco core tech team and our own tech team. It's 9 hours. To deal with 9 hours of difference, even if this is why also we've picked Kansas City, it's to have at least half a day in common, you know, because it's so complicated to communicate and to. It's so easy to postpone meetings, etc. And so you really have to take care of the way you are communicating with the team. So this is it was really hard. We knew that it was hard with Kansas City, but at least it was half a day. And wow, working with San Francisco, it's much more complicated. But we are still doing that.
Have you changed your pattern then of that monthly visit to Kansas City and San Francisco from Montpellier?
So when we've been acquired, the Kansas City team has been split between San Francisco and the Madison office, because Madison is really close to Kansas City. So my Kansas City team moved to Madison, which is very close, and or to San Francisco. So it was cool for the KC young guys, you know, to move to San Francisco. So, thank you, Richard. So.
And anything that you expected to be very difficult about the transition that was actually quite easy?
I think I was very worried for my team, you know, about, and most importantly about the core team, you know, from the beginning, because the core team of a startup, you know, they are not money-driven guys. They are following you because they believe in a goal in particular, in your ambition, create an empire. So, you know, when they are acquired, you are super worried about, okay, retention, etc. For those guys, it's not something really meaningful, you know, because they are not following you for that. So I was really worried, but they've all managed to find their own path within Zendesk, and because Zendesk is so, it's such a promising big startups, you know, it's only a 10 years old companies, and they are on trends like that. They have lots of ambition, very very cutting edge technologies, and they are still acquiring very cutting edge technologies as well. So there is lots of very technical challenges as well, and I know that I was much more worried than actually is the reality, because they are all finding their path.
Like, did you get a sense that at some point it stopped becoming a Rachel problem and it became a Zendesk problem? That they thought that was important as well.
Oui. And this is the best way. This is when it started to be like that, it means that the integration is working well, and that the acquisition start to be a success. So yeah.
Okay, cool. So we've time for some questions. If you guys want to stand up, make your question a question, and introduce yourselves as well. So we got some mics at the front here.
For your information, it's Kansas City, Missouri. Not Kansas City, Kansas. Missouri,
no shit,
it's
really?
The hipster part of Kansas City.
Okay. Presumed it was Kansas yeah. City. Lynn.
Hi, thank you, Rachel. Thank you. It was very insightful.
Sorry, I'm always looking at here,
okay.
But.
I'll look at her.
I have a question about your client wins and client losses, maybe?
Mm-hmm. Related to the acquisition or not at all?
Not no. Your first customers, rather, when you were early stage.
The first customer was we were testing our new billing system, and at night, the first credit card in the US was entered, and we are having a magic business. That's great. Let's go on. And it was a very small company, but in the middle of the US, maybe it was a sign. All the SaaS businesses, all the modern businesses, you know, they were somehow our targets, and they were the among our first customers. But as I mentioned, you know, among the very incredible customers, we had the Salvation Army, the American Nurse Association. It was, but we also had very prestigious references, San Francisco based, you know, very hot startups as well. So for the source of friends, young guys, you know, it was great. And after about the losses, yes, there is always this is when we've started to think about establishing a team in the US, because at some point, for those very hot companies in San Francisco, for example, the fact that we were not able to answer rapidly to their needs. This is where it started to, you know, to we started to miss revenue, and well, it was not a good sign that we were sending to our customers. So we've lost some of them, and this is where we made that decision to move. We had people from Uzbekistan as well, you know, from Iran as well. So when you are acquired by a US company, an IPO'd company, you have to stop that kind of relationships, paying relationships with those customers who are listed. People from Cuba, we couldn't because of regulation. So this is also, you are also learning of all that. There are some disappointments, you know, also, but that's the game of the US acquisition as well. So it's very interesting. And also with the SaaS business, we were seeing some customers on the 1st of January. We were saying, what are those people doing on the 1st of January? You know, they just want to play with a business analytics solution. Are they mad? But I love this kind of business. Yeah.
I think there's a question just behind. Right.
Can I not stand up as well? Mm-hmm. Hi. You were saying earlier on that you started to get noticed as you were developing the product, and you started to get your first customers that way. I mean, at a more practical level, I mean, what does that mean? You started to get noticed. I mean, do you have a marketing campaign going on? How did you get your inbound?
We were creating lots of content. So we've never used AdWords. We've started to use AdWords when Zendesk acquired us because they knew very well how to deal with that. But at first, the money I got was only to pay the engineering team. So it was product first. And it was my role at the beginning, at the early beginning, after we scaled a little bit that with the team. But we were mostly creating content. It was a very new topic. Cloud, business analytics, business intelligence, using AWS, Google BigQuery, stuff like that. So it was a way for us to, it was a good opportunity for us to position ourselves as thought leaders. And when you are a thought leader, you get attention from analysts also. So without zero marketing investments, we've been a Gartner cool vendor, which is really great, you know, when you are a SaaS B2B from a social proof, you know, even for your customers, etc. And we were creating lots of content. And lots of content about this industry, the kind of technologies we were using, the kind of use cases we were creating, and what our customers were doing. So it was lots of. I also tried to interview lots of my customers for testimonials, but also lots of experts in this industry. We were very well referenced on Google, you know, for all that, and for until the acquisition, when you were writing, you know, SaaS business intelligence. So there were the AdWords, you know, paid advertising companies who paid for advertising, and us as a well. And create content creation. It's your only. But it's lots of time to dedicate to that, but it's key because it brings you natural, voilà, and possibility to be a thought leader. Then you are inviting to speak during BI events, so you are positioning yourself. Voilà.
Thank you. Can I just another question?
Small one.
Yeah, okay. you said you had two competitors that were based in the Valley.
Wait.
How did you, along your journey, how did you think about that? Was it always present in your mind, or were you just thinking about, look, we do the best we can?
It's always great to have this kind of competitors on your market, and even if at some point we were some kind of blushing because each time we were raising funds, and they were raising funds at the same time, they were adding a zero. So, you know, so you say, oh, I'm so small. But it was great for us to see that US VCs were investing in this kind of companies on the same market. So it was a very good signal for us. It was a good signal to reuse when we were raising funds in Europe. For me, it was great signs actually, and to be honest, if you found the whole planet was our playground. So before starting, you know, to eat in the portfolio of each other, you know, we We had so much to do to disrupt this market, to tap into the planet Earth, you know, portfolio of SMEs, at least, you know, so.
So I remember signing up to your service way back when you started, and I kept getting your letters, newsletters for about 4 or 5 years.
Right.
So I tracked the journey. The thing that baffled me was, you know, there was a large crop of similar offerings at that point of time. So the question is, what is the value proposition that you found broke through for you? And just a slightly related question, did you ever consider dropping the horizontal approach and focus on a very sharp vertical that, you know, you could focus on and develop use cases for?
We were different because of the we made the choice since the beginning to, you know, from your web browser to be able to connect the data sources, to connect the data where they are, you know. Part of our competitors, they were still asking you to download the data on your own server, you know, to be able to process and analyze those data. So the fact that we were really, we had this seamless usage, you know, and consumption of data, it was something very different compared to our competitors. So you have to know that, you know, it's not something super easy to explain, but people who were trying different products, including us, at some point, we were much more easier to consume. We were using a lot our partnership with Google also to show how cutting edge we were in a big data context, you know, using those technologies online, being able to process billions of rows of data and having a result, you know, in seconds. It was something really new. So we really created lots of content about that, and analysts also positioned ourselves, helped us to position ourselves regarding our competition. On all those points, and it helped us tremendously. To talk about.
Did you focus on a vertical?
Sorry.
Or did you choose to focus on a vertical, or did you, you know, stick to a horizontal strategy?
If we focused, I'm sorry.
Focus on the vertical industry.
Ah, oui, on the vertical. Sorry. No, we were not. We were not really focusing on the vertical, but naturally we had much more the marketing industry and our marketing departments within large company using our solution. So at some point we were crafting a story about marketing use cases, but our competitors as well, you know. So we were much more generalist at the beginning, and creating lots of content coming from our testimonials. It's really key. Reuse all what you can from your customers, you know, talking about you, because they are using the right words also to talk about your product, and it helps you to craft marketing campaigns as well. So it's, you know, you don't have even to brainstorm too much. Use their own words, and you have to spend time for that.
Question there, James.
Hi, Richard. Thanks for sharing your story. I'm curious, gender has been topical recently, and the difference between the gender, maybe you may have noticed, between the US and Paris being a female CEO. I'd like to hear your views, please.
I've always, today, for example, I'm trying to, after the acquisition, I'm also investing my own money, my personal money, into startups, and I'm trying to focus on female tech entrepreneurs, female CEOs, okay? So this is I am conscious, I am aware that there is a gender problems, because there is a very few women attending this kind of events. Well, not this one, but and congratulations for the 45% of female speakers at your event. But today I was in a room where I was the only one, talking about SaaS, B2B, tech stuff, etc., the only one. Well, so I am aware there is still a problem about that. Europe is... whether it's Europe, the US, there is lots of initiatives, you know, but it's still the beginning. And on my side, I have never felt, how can I say that? it has never been a big problem for me. I was using and abusing of this female position, because when you are launching a business, it's so difficult to differentiate your business yourself that you have to use your personal marketing. You have to use you don't have the same weapon, you know. Mm. And for me, standing out in the crowd of a male-dominated industry, you know, it was very important to position myself as a female CEO in this tech industry and in the tech industry, in the BI industry. Mm. And each time I was in an event, I was the only one, but it's catching the attention. So. Well, I used and abused of that as well, but there are still lots of work to do in this area, and I'm a big believer of positive discrimination. This is what I'm doing at my personal level, trying to invest only in women in tech. And if we are all doing that at a little scale, we will, you know, in French we said that the little rivers do the big river, you know. Les petites rivières font les grands fleuves. Donc, so it's a way for us to contribute to that.
Thank you. Lish, can you grab the mic there? Thank you.
I actually find it very interesting to see a female entrepreneur and then also a financial controller. So while you are making your decisions, how to invest and how to grow the company, was it always revenue-based? Were you thinking, the more salespeople I have, the more sales I have, or was it profit-based? So how did you decide the ratios between all of this, and how did you make these decisions?
At first, it's product first. Product and what do I have to... What is my market fit with the product? And then it's the traction. Okay, can I have something sustainable? Can I have something that is the market fit? A reality, so scalability, traction, and then of course as soon as possible, so it's revenue generation, etc. And then I've never been afraid of raising money and be back in be back in a non-profitable company, just to be sure that after, you know, I was creating this empire, you know, you have to go through those phases. But the fact that I was coming from this financial background, I was super sensitive on cost controlling, you know, but I made some decisions that were not really good at some point. You know, for example, I've tried to save money on the audio video systems, and it was completely stupid because I was very proud to use Zoom and Slack tools, etc., to ease the communication between my teams, overseas. But I was not able to invest, you know, enough money in cool audio video systems. So this cost control stuff, you know, it's good for VCs. They are seeing that there are, you know, people that are aware about what money costs, you know, and but sometimes I was too much in this cost control and not enough, you know, growth oriented. But product, show tractions first, and then it was. I have no problem with sharing my capital, for example, sharing the shares. I knew that I wanted something big. And to have something big, you have to share. You have to have smart people entering, you know, the team, entering your capital. So I had no problem with that. And those people, they are reminding you that growth, you know, and that's fine if you're not completely profitable at first. But because I was super, sometimes I had this complex of not being profitable.
So I'm just going to do a follow-on question there, because that's really interesting about like sharing the success and sharing the equity. I know that we have a situation here in Ireland where it's really difficult to easily reward employees on equity positions, right? Because of the tax. It's like compared to the UK, but compared to the US, it's another story completely. Mm. I get a sense that France is probably a difficult place to reward employees as well. Did you think about bringing the whole company to Kansas City, Missouri? Did your investors push you to do that?
It's difficult in France, for sure, but since the last 3 to 4 years, there is the system is much more flexible, you know, so this is why also I'm part of this lobbying association to be sure that what we are winning, you know, through time for our employees, it's not changing, that there is this stability from a tax standpoint for our employees as well. So there is lots of work to do with government for that. It's much more complex, of course, but there is so many incentives also staying in France. The local engineering schools are very good. You are also benefiting from tax reduction on the engineering jobs. You know, when you are hiring engineers, there is less. You are paying less tax if you are recognized as an innovative company. But it's a big incentive, and the local engineering workforce is very good at low cost. So maybe I would have saved money going to the US on this topic, mm-hmm. but the salaries and the competition and the turnover on my core product team would have been a nightmare. So you have to do the choice. Okay. You have to choose.
We've time for maybe one or two more questions. That food smells amazing. I don't know if it's just me sitting here smelling the pizza. I want more questions, but I want pizza as well. So I'm kind of conflicted. Do we have many more questions? Let's go for two more. So this gent here and then one more lucky punter.
You mentioned a couple of times that you went to the States because of the time zone difference and supporting the customers.
What?
I just wonder if you had the opportunity to operate 24 hours in South France, how would that have affected your rate of conversion and sales process? Do you think you could have done it that way?
No, because going to the US, it was so a way to answer our customers, but it was also a way to show that we were having this scalable story, being able to have operating teams in different time zones. What I could do, what I could replicate from the US in Asia or in maybe Australia or else, you know, it was the proof of my scalability also from a business standpoint. There is the product technology scalability, but there is also your processes. And So I needed to, and you are also looking for social proof. I think it's stupid, but the more articles you have from US journalists, the more French journalists dare to talk about you. That's crazy, huh? That's crazy, but it's a reality, and it's still a reality. And so the more I was making noise in the US with my PR team in the US, in San Francisco, talking about our Kansas City stories, etc., the more I had articles in Europe, so the more I was building my European social proof as well to my European customers. So, you know, you have to be present and you have to show yourself and to prove yourself where there is the most noise in your industry, and then this is something that you can reuse. It's stupid. You understand what I mean? French journalists, they didn't want to talk about us, but when we started to show them that we are working with Google, doing really big tech scene, Google I/O, you know, speaking on stage, etc., with our French technology, then they said, oh, maybe we could interview. First, I don't care about having a French article. It doesn't scale my company, guys. But thanks for caring about us, you know, after 3 years. But, you know, what it means is that we needed this American, you know, story to have to be much more confident in at the rest of the on the rest of the planet.
Chloe.
Hi Rachel, thank you. We've talked about your competitors at an early stage. I was wondering what kind of future do you see now for the company in terms of competition now that BI is becoming more and more something that we see, and you probably have more and more competitors now.
And the good news is that now we are backed by Zendesk to compete, which senior people with much more marketing resources, much more technical resources, and it was also a good time for us, a good move to bring the analytics, ambition to upper scale, you know, being backed by Zendesk. So yeah, we are fully armed now. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's a question from somebody from Salesforce, right? So there's a lot of thinking going on. I'm gonna leave it there. No, I'm gonna leave it there because I'm starving. But Rachel is also gonna stay around for a little bit longer and have a drink and a pizza.
All the best for your businesses, guys. And this story, it's only my prism, you know, my story. And I just wanted to stress tonight that you can have unconventional stories. That's fine to not have the same path that, you know, TechCrunch is talking about, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You can have a prosperous businesses and being acquired, but being the acquisition is not a goal.
I think that's a wonderful note to end it on. So I'd like to, on behalf of Startup Grind, thank our speaker, Rachel Delacroix.
Thank you.